Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, you will hear reports from John Russell and Jill Robbins. Later, Bryan Lynn presents this week's science report. Finally, we hear today's lesson of the day. But first, John Russell has this story.
A man in the northeastern state of Massachusetts has regained his voice after a rare operation. Marty Kedian received a total transplant of his larynx, the organ responsible for speech, commonly called the voice box. Transplants of the larynx are very unusual and normally are not available to people with active cancer. Kedian is only the third person in the United States to receive a total larynx transplant. Doctors removed Kedian's cancerous larynx and replaced it with a donated one. Surgeons at the Mayo Clinic in Arizona offered Kedian the transplant as part of a new study. The study, known as a clinical trial, aims to open the operation to more patients, including some with cancer, the most common way to lose a larynx. "People need to keep their voice," 59-year-old Kedian told the Associated Press 4 months after the transplant operation. His voice sounded rough, but he was able to keep up a discussion for an hour. He added, "I want people to know this can be done." Kedian became emotional when describing the first time he phoned his 82-year-old mother after the surgery. "And she could hear me. That was important to me, to talk to my mother." The study is small. Just 9 more people will take part. But it permits scientists to learn more about these complex transplants. One day, doctors might offer these operations to more people who cannot breathe, swallow, or speak on their own because of a damaged or surgically removed larynx. Dr. David Lott is chair of head and neck surgery at the Mayo Clinic in Arizona. He said he started the study because, "My patients tell me, yeah, I may be alive, but I'm not really living." Lott's team reported early results of the surgery recently in the publication Mayo Clinic Proceedings. The larynx might be best known as the voice box, but the larynx is also important for breathing and swallowing. Muscular tissue flaps called vocal cords open to let air into the lungs, close to prevent food or drink from going the wrong way, and move when air pushes past them to produce speech. The first 2 U.S. larynx transplants took place at the Cleveland Clinic in 1998 and the University of California, Davis in 2010. The patients who received them had lost their voices to injuries. But cancer is the biggest reason for voice loss. The American Cancer Society estimates that more than 12,600 people will be found to have some form of laryngeal cancer this year. While today many undergo voice-preserving treatment, thousands of people have had their larynx completely removed. These people often breathe through what is called a tracheostomy tube in their neck. They can struggle to communicate. Although the earlier U.S. recipients were able to reach near normal speech, doctors have not fully accepted these transplants. That is partly because people can survive without a larynx. At the same time, special drugs that limit the immune system could create new or reappearing tumors. We want to be able to push those boundaries, but do it as safely and ethically as we can, Lott said. Head and neck specialists say the Mayo trial is important to helping larynx transplants become a choice. It isn't a one-off, but an opportunity to finally learn from one patient before operating on the next, said Dr. Marshall Strom, who led the 1998 transplant in Cleveland. The first attempt in a cancer patient is the next important step, he said. Other possibilities are being studied, noted Dr. Peter Balafsky of UC Davis, who helped perform the 2010 transplant. His patients at high risk of larynx loss record their voice in hopes of using new speech devices that sound like them. Balafsky said larynx transplants might become more common, but he warned it likely will take years of additional research. I'm John Russell.
Human doctors perform amputations or removal of an arm, leg, or finger after a serious injury. The purpose of this action is to prevent infection or disease. But humans are not alone in doing them. New research shows that some ants perform amputations on injured ants to help them survive an injury. The behavior was documented in Florida carpenter ants, also known by their scientific name, Camponotus floridanus. The reddish-brown insect is about 1.5 centimeters long. They live in parts of the southeastern United States. Scientists said they observed these ants treating injured ants in the colony in two ways. They either cleaned the wound using their mouth parts, or amputated the limb or leg by biting it off. The choice of care depended on the injury's location. When it was further up the leg, they always amputated. When it was further down, they never amputated. Eric Frank of the University of Würzburg in Germany is the lead writer of the research. It appeared recently in the publication Current Biology. Frank said, the study describes for the first time how a non-human animal uses amputations on another individual to save their life. He believes that the ant's medical system to care for the injured is the most sophisticated in the animal kingdom and compares well to human medicine. The researchers studied injuries to the upper part of the leg, the femur, and the lower part, the tibia. Such injuries are commonly found in different kinds of ants while fighting and hunting among insects and animals. However, they watched the ants in a laboratory. Frank said that the ants decide between amputating the leg or spending more time caring for the wound. How they decide this, we do not know. But we do know why the treatment differs. It has to do with the flow of hemolymph, the bluish-green fluid equivalent to blood in most invertebrates, or animals without a backbone. Injuries further down the leg have an increased hemolymph flow, Frank said. so harmful bacteria can enter the body after only 5 minutes. An amputation would not help infection after that time. He continued, injuries further up the leg have a much slower hemolymph flow, giving enough time for timely and effective amputations. In either case, the ants first clean the wound using fluids from their mouth. The amputation process itself takes at least 40 minutes and sometimes more than 3 hours. The ants keep biting the patient at the shoulder. The study found that after an upper leg injury, an ant who experiences amputation has a survival rate of 90 to 95%. For lower leg injuries in which just cleaning was performed, the survival rate was about 75%, compared to about 15% for injuries that received no care. Ants can function well without one of their 6 legs, and only female ants perform the treatment of wounds by cleaning or amputation. All worker ants are female. Males play only a minor role in ant colonies, Frank said. I'm Jill Robbins.
Four scientists have left a model Mars environment where they lived in isolation for more than a year. The crew took part in the experiment for the American Space Agency, NASA. Team members included Commander Kelly Haston, Medical Officer Nathan Jones, Flight Engineer Ross Brockwell, and Science Officer Anka Salariu. They ended their stay after 378 days on July 6th. The simulated Mars environment is called a habitat. NASA said the project was designed to help scientists, engineers, and mission planners better understand how living on another world could affect human health and performance. Officials said the habitat also aimed to recreate certain environmental pressures that future astronauts could face while living in places like the Moon and Mars. The experiment took place inside a specially designed area at NASA's Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas. The 160-square-meter environment where the crew members lived was built using 3D printing technology. The experiment involved the crew completing several research activities. These included taking part in robotic operations, looking after the habitat, doing physical exercise, and growing crops. The members also took place in simulated Mars walks. The crew members are not NASA astronauts. They left their normal jobs to take part in the experiment. After leaving the habitat, the group was to complete a series of post-mission data collection activities over 2 weeks before returning home. While inside the environment, NASA said the crew was subject to Mars realistic time delays during communications with the outside world. This meant there could be delays of up to 44 minutes round trip for communication data. In addition, the members had to deal with a limited food system, similar to what astronauts use on the International Space Station, ISS, or during future space deployments. Commander Haston, a biologist, was the first to speak during a ceremony to mark the mission's end. Hello, it's actually so wonderful just to be able to say hello to you, she said with a laugh. Jones, who works as an emergency room doctor, was overcome with emotion after leaving the habitat. I really hope I don't cry standing up here in front of all of you, he said. Brockwell, a structural engineer, said the experience showed him the importance of living sustainably to help mankind on Earth. I'm grateful for the chance to live the idea that we must utilize resources no faster than they can be replenished and produce waste no faster than they can be processed back into resources, he said. Solariu, a microbiologist, explained that she had been asked by people many times why humans like her would even want to go to Mars. Because it's possible, she said. Because space can unite and bring out the best in us. She added, because it's one defining step that Earthlings will take to light the way into the next centuries. The NASA program is officially called the Crew Health and Performance Exploration Analog, or CHAPEA. The agency says the latest experiment was the first of three it plans to carry out. The target for the next one will be sometime in 2025. Steve Corner is the deputy director of Johnson Space Center. He said most of the experiment centered on nutrition and how that affected the crew's performance. The work was crucial science as we prepare to send people on to the Red Planet. Corner added, they've been separated from their families, placed on a carefully prescribed meal plan, and undergone a lot of observation. He noted that Mars is our goal and called the project an important step in America's ongoing efforts to be a leader in future world space exploration activities. Under its Artemis program, NASA plans to send humans back to the moon in order to learn how to live in space for long periods. After that, the goal is to send astronauts to Mars. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn joins me now to talk more about his science report. Hi, Bryan. Thanks for being here.
Sure, Ashley. Thanks for having me.
This week, your report was about a group of people who just ended a year-long stay in a Mars habitat created by NASA. What can you tell us about how this environment was set up?
Yes, so the habitat is about 160 square kilometers, so quite a small space for four individuals. And in photos made available, it shows several different areas. These include a common working space with computers and other equipment. Each person had a small sleeping space, and there is also an exercise room, kitchen area, a room for growing food, and a space to relax for free time.
When they came out, did the crew members talk much about the relationships they developed with one another while spending that much time together in such a small space?
Yes, some did. As might be expected, a couple of the team members got emotional talking about the experience. And part of that was because they were so glad to be able to see their loved ones after such a long time. But also there was a sense it was hard to say goodbye to each other as well. Several of them said they used the time to get to know each other. And they talked also about finding ways to relax and have fun times inside as well. One crew member also noted that even though the experiment lasted more than a year, the time really did seem to fly by.
All right. Thanks again for being here, Bryan.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Welcome to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. My name is Andrew Smith.
And my name is Jill Robbins. Thanks for joining us. Today's lesson will help you learn more about the English you hear in our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
In our previous lesson of the day, we heard Anna going to visit a beekeeper, even though she is afraid of bees. In today's podcast lesson, we're going to hear her meeting the bees and learning how to care for them.
In lesson 13 of our Let's Learn English Level 2 series, Anna and the beekeeper, Caroline, are putting on their gear to go and see the bees. Anna is afraid of bees, but like many wise women, she has decided to face her fear and try to overcome it.
I have a feeling that your fear of bees will be gone soon. There are things beekeepers do to protect ourselves. For example, we wear protective clothing. This is a beekeeper's veil, suit, and gloves. There are other things we can do too. If I use the smoker, the bees will stay calm.
Let's use smoke. Lots of smoke.
Okay, Anna, that's enough smoke. Another thing you can do is stay calm. Okay, when I lift the frame, you will see the bees.
I'm ready. Let's do this thing.
Okay, let's put on our protective clothing.
As we mentioned in our previous podcast, this lesson is about conditional statements. We hear Caroline using a type 1 conditional in this part.
If I use the smoker, the bees will stay calm.
A smoker is a tool beekeepers use to burn a small amount of fuel. It produces cool smoke that distracts the bees, so they don't pay attention to what the beekeeper is doing. It looks like a can with a pointed top.
The other new words we heard in this part describe the gear, or special clothes, beekeepers wear. Anna and Caroline put on a veil. That's spelled V-E-I-L, which is a kind of thin white net that covers a person's head. You can see through a veil, but the bees cannot fly through it.
In Western weddings, you might see the bride, the woman who's getting married, wear a veil over her face. The other gear they put on is a suit. It's also white and covers the entire body, so if the bees do get angry, they cannot find a place to sting you.
And finally, they put on thick gloves. These protect the beekeeper's hands not only from stings, but also from the heat from the smoker.
We should probably explain the word sting here. That is what we call a bite from an insect. Let's go back to Caroline's backyard now and see how they're doing with those bees.
Here, we learn how the beekeeper handles the bees. Listen to see if you can understand the different kinds of bees Caroline describes.
I will carefully take out a frame. This is where the bees live. There are worker bees, drone bees, and the queen bee. The bees have different jobs. The queen bee lays the eggs. The worker bees collect nectar and pollen from flowers and bring it back to the hive. Then they make honey. Now you hold the frame. There are the bees.
There are so many, and they are so busy. Now I know why we say, busy as a bee.
Good job, Anna.
She said she first takes out a frame. That is a flat screen with wood around the edges. The bees live and work on the frame inside a box, which serves as their hive. Hive is spelled H-I-V-E, and it means the home of some kinds of insects.
Did you hear the kinds of bees? One is a worker. They are the ones we see flying around to collect pollen from flowers. That's the yellow dust inside the flowers that is food for the bees.
Right, and pollen is what makes some of us sneeze when there's too much in the air. The worker bees bring it home to their hive and make honey with it. Next, we have the drones and the queen bees.
I guess the queen is the big boss, right, Jill?
Yeah, that's because she's the mother of everyone. She lays up to 2,000 eggs a day. She just hangs around in the hive, and the worker bees feed her.
Wow. And what do the drones do?
They are just around to mate with the queen, so she can lay eggs. They might not even get to do that, because the queen only needs to mate once. And here's a cruel fact of life. The worker bees throw the drones out of the hive before they close up the hive for the winter.
Wow, that is rough. The poor drones. But it seems Anna has overcome her fear of bees if she is close enough to see what's going on inside the hive. Let's listen again to find out how her attitude has changed.
Caroline, bees are beautiful and important. If I wanted to help the bees, what would I do?
Great question. You can plant native flowers that bees like. Here's a book to help you know which ones to plant.
Oh, it's a beautiful book. And look, it tells you which bees like which types of flowers.
It also tells you how the flowers affect the flavor of the honey.
Flowers make a big difference to bees. If they don't eat, they won't live.
Buying local honey also helps the bees. If you want to help bees, do those two things.
I heard some more conditionals there. Let's see if our listeners can identify this one. Is it type 1, that is, with a present tense verb, or type 2, with a past tense verb?
If I wanted to help the bees, what would I do?
So that's type 2, right? The situation is possible, but it's not real yet.
Yep. Let's try another one.
If they don't eat, they won't live.
That's type 1. The situation is real.
And Professor Bot has an interesting comment. Remember, he's our little robot teacher in this series. He says,
I learned a lot about bees. Hey, if I worked with bees, I would not need protective clothing.
Well, that's true. Professor Bot is a robot, so the bees cannot sting him. That makes this a type 2 conditional. The situation is possible, and the main verb and the modal are both in the past form. But of course, we're not talking about the past time. The main verb is in the past form to indicate that it's a conditional, that it's not a real condition.
And I think we've learned a lot about bees, as well as the conditional forms today. Write to us about your own experiences with bees. You can email us at learningenglish@voanews.com.
And remember, you can also find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm as busy as a bee, Dr. Jill.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.